Hi, everyone. I'm Angel Borrelli, and welcome to Season 7, Episode 1 of The Fix. And it's so great to be back. And before we get started, I want to extend a welcome to The Fix's newest addition, Coach Larry Owens. Hey, Larry. So happy to have you here.
Hi, Angel. Thanks for having me. Really appreciate you inviting me.
I'm so glad you're here, and he's going to be with us for all you listeners every show. And Larry, for those of you who don't know, has been a guest for the last few seasons, and he's just so popular, and he brings so much to the table in terms of his experience and his knowledge that I feel lucky to have him. In case you don't know who Larry is, he's the current head coach at Bellarmine University. He's a former MLB minor league pitching coach and a retired left-handed pitcher. Can you believe how brave I am having a lefty on the show? Are you going to act like a lefty, Larry? I want to ask you that.
All the time.
That's great. That's so great. So everyone, we've got a great first episode for you. Larry is going to have his very own little segment at the beginning of the podcast called, of course, Top of the First. And who knows what he's going to talk about, what he's going to ask, what he's going to complain about, what he's going to be happy about. We never know. We'll have to wait and see. And in the middle segment, the teaching moment today, the title of my segment is Get a Grip. And I think you know what that is going to be about. And of course, the third segment, you know, that's my little personal segment. It's always a surprise. So we'll wait to see what happened. So let's get started. So Larry, here we go. It's the top of the first.
Top of the first. Well, thank you. Well, this isn't something that's just come up. It's been something that's been going on for years. For a couple of years, I would get in the habit of asking kids we're recruiting or current players, how many times in your youth career did you throw multiple innings back-to-back days playing summer baseball? And every time the answer was every weekend. It was just constant. And it's something that I think continues to go on. I don't know if it's anyone's fault or if it's there's something we could do to improve it, but it seems to be ongoing. And then like you mentioned in talking with you, you know, kids are throwing twice in one day, which isn't the best thing in the world to do. So for me, multiple innings, back-to-back days, throwing twice in one day, it's something that I think needs to slow down or stop. And a way we could do it would, in my suggestion would be build your roster in such a way that you can do that so that you can cover the innings for the weekend. And if your roster still needs to be fairly thin, which is typically 11, 12, 13 guys, then give somebody the ball and let them go pitch. Let them try it. Work at it in practice. Give them an opportunity to, how they can cover an inning or two for you in a tournament, which can be very beneficial and then perhaps keep you from using someone multiple innings back-to-back days or feeling like you got to throw a guy twice in a day. So what gets in the way a lot of times is they want to try and win the game. They want to try and win the tournament, and I don't blame them. I mean, the scoreboard's on for a reason. You want to win the game. But at the same time, not at the expense of someone's health. You may not see an injury in the immediate future by using a kid that way, but down the road, you know, it's going to take its toll. And that is, I think, a contributing factor. It's not the only factor, but it's a contributing factor to the rash of arm injuries we get. And I think as college baseball coach, I think we get damaged goods sometimes. I think kids show up on campus, you know, they're an injury waiting to happen or they've already been injured. So not to gripe and complain about it, but I think it's something we can, as an industry, as a group, we can do a better job of. Just try to do your best. If you have a 12-man roster, encourage guys to pitch. Try to get everybody on your club to pitch. And I know some guys that do that with their teams, but there are others that don't. And so if we're going to continue to play in these tournaments where you're expected to, you know, maybe play 5 to 6 games in 3 days, your roster better be built to cover those innings. And in most cases, they're not. It's going to take some teams and coaches to change that.
Well, first of all, I love we're having this conversation because this is an ongoing problem. And this reminds me of a conversation we had the other day, and you said something so profound. Just a few words. I was asking you, why did Otani get hit or injured when he comes to this country when he was doing these bizarre, crazy things in Japan? He was hitting and pitching, and their numbers are insane. They don't recover, blah, blah, blah. And you said one thing to me. I said, Larry, how should we look at this? I mean, it's a strange thing. And he goes, well, it probably caught up with him. And it was so simple, yet so profound, because in my mind, I know that when a pitcher is injured, yes, we have acute injuries. Like you fall down the stairs, that's an acute injury. You have a back problem, that's maybe something over time. In pitching, most injuries are injuries that occur over time. They don't just pop up out of nowhere. And kids are so resilient in the sense that, one, they never are able to identify a pain. So we never really know what's going on with them. Because of the way the bones are still growing and the way the muscles are attached, there's stress being placed into places that don't hurt you. You can't feel your bone, but you can feel a muscle. But if the muscle's so kind of floppy, you may not know it's overstressed. So we've got this problem with injuries occurring in kids from pitching. And because of the lack of communication, meaning they can't tell you something's wrong, they may not even show you something's wrong. The way a pitcher can, you know, he'll wave his arm out or do something and you'll know, what's he doing? He looked funny there. Kids don't even do that. And because they're playing and running around so much, they can't really even center on one part of their body. So we've got the performer who's getting injured and doesn't know it. And the injuries that occur to pitchers are invisible injuries. So you can't just look at them and know. And so we have to, I think, set it up for protection. It's just like we know 12-year-olds shouldn't drive a car. So let's have the law be that they have to be 16. We're setting them up to protect them. And that way we know we've done the most that we can. So with the youth pitchers, this is a constant problem. And I love on this show where we can bring things up, and I love to be able to have solutions. But I think even though this is not an easy solution, I think that we can have conversation that stimulates the brains of the youth coaches that are listening. So when you and I have talked about this before, and this has also come up on the show, the most important thing with pitchers is that they recover from their pitch count. And the pitch count that, and I use the U.S. Baseball Association's pitch count. I've been using it since the beginning, and I use the first version of them. So let's just talk about a pitcher who's 12 and under. They can go up to 34 pitches, and they need one day recovery. Larry, I think you said sometimes there's two games on one day, two games the next, or sometimes it's a three-day tournament and it's 2-2-1.
Yeah, tournaments vary, but generally speaking, they probably play two games on a Friday, two games Saturday, and then, you know, at least one, maybe more on Sunday. To win it, they're going to have to play more than one on Sunday. And there's tournaments vary. They may go Wednesday through Sunday.
Right, but there are a number of days. So this is not a surprise to coaches. This is not like, oh, wow, we've got this tournament. So the first thing is, I know I've been talking about this since I started working with pitchers, which is way back in 95. So, and then really working with them personally since 2001. So this has been going on for more than 20 years. So this is no surprise. So coaches, it's no surprise you're going to be in this predicament. Secondly, the main thing that coaches, I want to get into your head is recovery is everything. It's not only important to prevent injury, but for the pitcher's performance. I mean, if you're using a guy in the morning, I can't imagine how he's going to be good in the afternoon. But you're not only dealing with using him twice. You're dealing with an arm that started to go into recovery, started cooling down, and then he had to get it back together again for the second game. If you're dealing with pitching him the next day, his arm's way into recovery. So you don't even have the chemistry that's available for good performance. Now, we know that there's a group of pitchers out there. They're called gamers, right? They'll get the job done no matter what. They might have to overthrow to do it or whatever, but they're putting even more themselves more at risk. So the ultimate goal is, when a pitcher pitches, he's done until he has followed whatever recovery is important. So last season, we talked about if there's a three-day tournament, you want your best guy on Friday and you want to put him in on Sunday if you win, then you're going to have to rotate him out of that game after he's thrown 34 pitches. And guess what? That may not be a game you want him to start. Maybe you do. Maybe you want to bring him in the third inning. But if you only have him throw 34, you can use him again. So that's one creative way to do it. But here's the thing that I want on coaches' minds. You're running a business and you need certain people. And if this was a regular business, you might need someone to answer the phones, and you might need someone at the computer, and you might need someone in the production room, and you might need somebody in the packaging room. You don't just start the business when you have three positions that aren't filled. When you are recruiting your team, and I've been out there for tryouts, there's like, Larry, am I right? When you have a youth tryout, are there like 200 little kids running around?
Yeah, it varies. I mean, yeah, it can be that large. Absolutely.
It is insane. So yes, you may only get four pitchers out of that. So, you know, you ask who's a pitcher, and let's say, well, sometimes kids all raise their hands, but let's say you've got 25 kids that are designated as pitchers and you want to see them pitch. And yeah, there may be only four that are worth it. But if you have a business that needs, I mean, minimally, wouldn't you need for a 2-day tournament? Because let's talk back to back, which is the biggest problem. For a 2-day tournament, four games, don't you minimally need eight guys?
You'd probably want to have at least eight. Yeah.
Yeah. At least eight. Yeah. And hope that they can go. Mm-hmm. And of course you hopefully coach them and develop them so they can. So let's say in an ideal world, and is this going to be a six, it's at 12 years old, Larry, out there by you. I think we're at, I think it's seven innings, but is it always seven?
Typically, I mean, at most it varies. It can vary a little bit. I would say generally speaking, 12 years and younger, they're playing six innings, and above 12 years old, they're probably playing seven innings, but I'm sure it varies a little bit.
Okay. So you've got someone that's going to go in for four, and he's going to go in for, and another one's going to go in for three. And then the next day you bring in some other pitchers. Okay. So if you know that you minimally need eight and probably want 10, hire them. Meaning recruit them, meaning make sure you have that on their team. Even if you have some that they pitch sometimes, but they're not always pitching, but you keep their arms in shape. And then when you do your planning, so somewhere, and I know I'm preaching to the choir here because you're a coach, but the thing is, we're not discussing this about coaches like yourself who are at D1 schools or D2s or D3s. College coaches, how many pitchers do you have on your team?
Oh, goodness. You could have anywhere from 15 to 18.
Exactly. Because you're not going to get caught in this situation.
Correct.
Exactly. So high school, I do see this happen sometimes in high school. But basically, at the high schools that are really the ones that do well, you don't really hear about this. And their better pitchers don't usually get caught up in doing it. In fact, what happens is the pitcher who's hardly a pitcher, he can get overused easily in a tournament because it's like he's not really a pitcher. They're throwing him in. But what I'm saying is the more knowledgeable, the greater level of the team, like yourself, you're not going to ever get caught in this position. And so you know that up front when you recruit and when you do what you do to gather your team. Youth coaches, you guys have to up your game as well as protecting the pitchers. And I think that I don't think youth pitchers and youth coaches know how important they are. You're one of the most important to the development of the pitcher. You're also one of the most important preventions for something that could happen to that pitcher down the road. And I know that it's a crazy schedule, and most of you guys are volunteer coaches. So this is a double whammy on you. But I think that you're good enough to be able to plan ahead. And I want coaches to start thinking about this, especially now when people are dying to get back to baseball. You're going to have a lot of people maybe available to you to create teams from. But I think that somewhere you have to have something in your head that's ideal, and then you keep striving for that ideal. And then on its own, the situation will start to improve. But I think that the most important message from your issue today is you can't see inside of a kid's body, and the kids that are injured at 15 and 16 and 14 and 13, it started when they were 9 and 10 and 11.
No doubt. I've never you know, I think winning gets in the way a lot of this. So I think guys get, people get caught up and want to try and win the game or win the tournament. And I understand that. But just in recruiting a kid, I've never asked him how many games or how many championships he won as a youth player. I've never asked him. I don't care. It's irrelevant. But I have asked a player, have you had any arm issues? So you just got to get over the winning thing. I mean, you can learn how to win and learn how to lose, and it be a big part of player development and development for all of your entire team. But winning is not the end all at these tournaments. And I could care less how many games you win as a youth player. I want to know, you know, are you interested in getting your degree? And can you help us win some championships? And if you've been hurt before, I need to know about it. Or if I know your history, I may shy away from you if I know you've been overused and abused. I'll just stay away from you.
Yes. Well, you know, that desire to win is the part of the youth coaches that makes them very similar to professional coaches. And it makes them similar to college coaches and people who are coaching for a living who want to win for many reasons and, of course, keep their jobs. So I think another point is, if you're going to play it to win, then set yourself up with a scenario that allows for winning to be possible in a way where pitchers might not be destined to lose because they are being overused. So recognize that, yes, I'm a youth coach and I want to win. Okay, well, you know what? I need to start thinking about having more pitchers. And then when you get them on your team, please give them bullpens. You know, so the complaint I want to add into this, especially now, I mean, I had a pitcher with a sore arm from playing an infield position, and I don't want to tell you the number of throws he had to make. And I said, why did that happen? And it's because right now in this day and age, so few people showed up to practice that the coach, who wanted to, of course, give substance to a practice, just, you know, the kids just were going crazy, and not the ability not to do bullpens. Pitchers need to pitch twice a week, once in a game, once in a bullpen, two bullpens a week when it's off season. But the other thing is, get these pitchers so you have enough, but then have them pitch. And even the guy who you don't really consider one of your top pitchers, if you think, if there's a 3-day tournament, they have to be throwing two bullpens. You do need to look at a calendar and plan ahead. So I think this is a great topic, Larry. We've got to keep it coming, because I think that sometimes you get so caught up in what you're doing that you don't see the forest for the trees. So you just keep on doing what you're doing. But yes, this is an important detail. So very nice. How did you like having your own little top of the first segment?
Pretty nice. I kind of like it.
I like it too.
Very good. Like very good. No, this topic's pretty important, very, very important to me personally. So I just, it's something that we see all the time. So I just wanted to make sure and be able to use this, you know, small platform to hopefully large platform to just let everybody know that, you know, we're watching, people are paying attention, and it's something we can get better at. So.
Yes. Well, I was actually just going to say that. I've been saying this for years. Come on, guys. Don't pitch them. But for a college coach, someone of your caliber, to say, hey, guess what? Even here, I may be hearing about what they did when they were 12. What they did when they were 12 is affecting their arm now. And also, I mean, just to have another coach bring this to the table, and I think it drives it home better. Yeah, so I love the topic. So anyway, let's move on to the teaching moment and get a grip. Of course, we're going to be talking about grips. And before we get into why we're talking about grips, I'm going to bust Larry, because he gave me a big headache a year ago, and my head still hurts. So as most of you know, when you listen to me talk, we're talking about the pitching motion and the everything due to anatomy and the way the body moves. And years ago, when data started showing up, when baseball pitching became data-driven, and then everyone was having statistics, and then you listen to a baseball game and you think you're listening to a statistics class, I really resisted even wanting to deal with that, because number one, I felt like it was out of my lane, and I like to stay in my lane. But number two, I didn't have any immediate way where I could connect it back to the work I do, which is if I see a problem in a pitcher's motion that I'm able to correct it. So a year ago, so I have been resisting this, and trust me, companies call me all the time. Do you want this equipment? Do you want that? And gimmicks and stuff. And I'm more of a on hands, real, change it the real way. And also don't bring numbers into my session, please. That's the main thing. The only number I pay attention in my session is how many pitches the pitcher's throwing. So a year ago, Larry calls me up and he says, he starts talking to me about data and he's telling me about this most interesting ball that he had. And it's a ball called Pitch Logic, and it's put out by F as in Frank, Five Sports. And by the way, Larry and I have no connection to this company in any way financial. We're not on the board of directors. But he called me up and said, Angel, there's this ball and has a little computer in it, and it gives you this reading. And I went, no, I don't want to hear about spin rate. Don't talk to me. Well, he didn't leave me alone. But the thing is, you can't unhear what you hear. And as somebody who is passionate about my work, I'm like, oh, and it was right before Christmas. So I'm walking around the house. I can't stop thinking, now, should I have this ball? I mean, should I even look at this ball? What should I do? So then I call him again. I go, tell me again about the ball. So anyway, the cool thing about this ball is it's completely affordable. You don't have to install anything. You just, you know, put the ball against your phone, which has an app on it, and boom, it's ready to go. The pitcher throws the ball, the catcher catches it, you retrieve the ball, it can't be hit, of course, and all these numbers pop up on your screen. So Larry's telling me about this, and I couldn't unhear it, plus I noticed my own stubbornness, so I went and got the ball, and then when I looked at it, I went, no, so I put the ball away. So then finally, I confess to Larry, I go, okay, I got to figure out a way where I can help, where if you get something crazy on the screen, like some spin rate that's really wrong or the type of spin is really wrong, that you don't just like, it's not doomsday for the pitcher. You like look at it as a tool to say, huh, what I'm seeing is what I'm seeing on the screen. And then I want to be a part of how do you fix it? So I've been in conversation with Larry over the last year about how to fix what we see on the screen. Now, we know, and correct me if I'm wrong, Larry, in the major leagues, they're taking all their great pitchers, and the numbers they're getting about the pitchers' different pitches are actually being used not necessarily, oh, something's wrong, but more like this is what he does. And so this is how we should strategize which pitches he uses. Am I correct about that?
Right. I wouldn't say that improvement or trying to improve something doesn't go on. I would imagine that that does. But for sure, if they do something that they feel can help them and they get feedback from the ball or they get data that they think can help them, they're going to use it. If you know, the pretty easy one is you got a high spin rate, we'll pitch in the top of the strike zone, you get a low spin rate, you sink it, then throw the ball down the strike zone. I mean, that's the general, you know, consensus. But I wouldn't say it's absolute and across the board, but I would say that, yes, they do want to take what you have and then, you know, use what you have to your advantage. I don't know how much they're looking at trying to improve things, but it can be done. And I know that it has been done to do that or to make things consistent, like an arm slot.
Yes. So they're using information for strategic purposes. But what's happening, and you may or may not know this because you're in the college world, but what's happening is coaches are, in fact, I just got a call yesterday and they asked me about a popular system and they said, well, what do you know about this? And I said, and I told them my story. And the thing is everybody now wants to know about these numbers and you can't help but wanting to know because when you listen to a game, it's all you hear. And if one place has it, then someone else feels they have it. So you go into facilities now and some pitching coaches use it, you know, they're using it instruction. And, you know, sometimes people are very comfortable with numbers, particularly if you're not working in a a modality like I am, which is to change the way the body moves. Okay. So here, what's happening now, and this is why I became so obsessed with this, is pitchers were calling me, fathers were calling me saying, I want to bring my son in. My son's spin rate was not high enough on his four seam. And so, you know, when we went to the showcase, I'm getting stories like that. And then I'm also getting kids saying, hey, I want, do you know what my spin rate is? Or this coach told me my spin rate was really good. Or, and so the, it is part of the normal conversation now. However, I never want to go completely to the other side, because the one session I brought it in to experiment with it, it was a crazy session for me, because as an artist, I wasn't able to do creative work when I was busy looking at numbers. It was really a challenge. But then over the sessions, I started realizing that it can be an interesting tool that I use, especially with some of my better pitchers. And so it is a wonderful tool to have. And what I love most about this company, in addition to the fact that they have the best customer service in the world, their guys are there and they're great, is that it's affordable. So knowing that everybody's getting into this equipment thing and knowing that everybody's getting into the data thing, I started thinking, well, if we're measuring spin, and if we're measuring, obviously there's velocity coming up, but spin's the thing. If we're mentioning spin, and if numbers, if they're giving spin rates the grade of it's good or bad, that is, coaches are looking at it and their brains are, the brain is of the coach is making a judgment of it. Oh, this spin is good. Oh, this spin is bad. If that is happening, then we need to understand, I need to, this is what I said, I need to reverse engineer, well, if his spin isn't quote unquote correct for what he's supposed to be throwing, and we all know without being physicists, we know there's different spins, and the spins are different between pitches, and you want to have that spin because you're trying to deceive the hitter, plus the spin is going to create something to do with how fast or the placement of that ball. So that spin is having an effect, and it's the last thing you apply to the ball. It's having an effect on where the ball lands. And we have to go back to the beginning. What are we trying to do? You're trying to throw a ball that he either doesn't swing at, but it's in the strike zone, or he swings at and misses because it was thrown so well or so confusing in a way that he swung incorrectly. Those are the objectives. So I reverse the two. Okay, well, I want to understand the actual fingers and the hand and the wrist even more on the grip, because if there is something you see that's wrong, you can't just say, oh, well, this isn't good. The kid's looking at you like, well, can we fix this? And we all have been doing this without data, right, Larry? We all have been looking at the strike zone going, we didn't like that pitch.
Correct.
Or that pitch was too slow. Or that pitch went over the catcher's head. We all have been making those evaluations. And so the tool, the data kind of confirms it. But if you think of it as a confirming thing, like another set of eyes that says, yep. And then you can start to work with some of the things that are personal to the pitcher, which is his wrist, his hand, making sure he's doing everything right. Then you can start to see if what you're doing is not only affecting some of the numbers you're looking at, but also it makes that data stuff tangible. And if the world wasn't going in that direction, we wouldn't be having this conversation. But since the world is, we need to have this conversation so we bring it more home, so pitchers aren't feeling like this is some disease they've been diagnosed with and then they're stuck with it. So my intention is to talk a little bit about the kinds of things a coach can look at and understand about the way the ball leaves the hand that is going to have an effect on the kinds of things that you guys want, which is the spin, the direction, the velocity, the location, et cetera. Does that make sense, Larry?
Absolutely, for sure. Can I hit on one thing real quick?
Yes.
You went back, you said we're trying to throw the ball where either they won't swing at it or they'll swing and miss. I'll add, or I want them to hit it. I just don't want them to hit it hard. You're looking for soft contact. You're not completely avoiding contact altogether. I want them to put the ball in play. But yes, point well taken. I just wanted to throw that in there.
No, that's important. No, yeah, no, it is important. And you know, that's why you're the baseball guy that I have on hand, because from the perspective I'm at, you know, I'm looking at, this is what we want, you know, on a performance level, but that's baseball stuff. You want the ball in play. You want to pitch to contact once in a while, or to have that be, and that's totally, no, and I'm glad that you mentioned that, and I expect you to do that for me, and I appreciate that. So, yeah, so anyway, in either case, we want to make sure that we're in control and the hitter isn't, that that ball is thrown in a way that can create one of those scenarios. So when I started, so I've of course talked about the wrist and the fingers before, but there's some very cool things in doing research. So there's researchers out there that are looking at the fingers, and they're looking at very specific ways the fingers move off the ball. And it's insane. And I tell you, you do not want to run and do this. Doing scientific research on the fingers and on the biomechanics of the way each knuckle works is absolutely insane. And it's why my head hurts. But what's so cool is when you really get this, you can go to a pitcher's hand. And the first thing you want to do, now let's say we're talking about a pitcher who's got good mechanics. So let's talk about the role of the mechanics with the hand. Okay. The reason why we have to be sure that the mechanics are correct. So let's talk about the speed of the ball. If when you come out of the glove, when you come out of the glove with the ball and the ball goes down and it goes out and it goes behind you towards the outfield, that ball is really not got a lot of energy to it. Your body is getting it in position so that it can then get to the hand and you can do what you need to do with it. But basically, that ball is just in your hand and it's just storing up and kind of waiting for the moment. When your front foot lands and you start to turn, now we've got energy that is moving up through the body of the guy holding the ball. And he's rotating and rotating and spinning and getting all his body into motion. So when he finally faces his target, the shoulder imparts speed to the wrist. And the hand is controlled by the wrist. And the fingers are going to control that last moment of when the ball leaves the hand. So when we are talking about releasing a ball at all, and we know that no matter what kind of spin you want or what kind of pitch you're throwing, you have to get energy from your shoulder to your wrist, and it passes through the elbow. And the wrist, in science, imparts about 21% of the velocity to the total velocity of the pitch. So it's important. So we want the wrist getting energy. So if you've got someone who, when you look at them, because to look at a grip is important, but the grip plus the way the pitcher's moving is critical. So if you're looking at someone who's doing something strange with his shoulder, or his arm is flying way up in the air, it's coming out of that compact position that we want to see pitchers do, you absolutely have to address that, because you can talk about spin all day and you can talk about location all day. But let's remember, and this isn't a show about the delivery, but I just want to point out that when you're starting to work with the hand and with the pitches, if this is somebody who, when you look at them, they're doing something odd at the level of the shoulder, that velocity or the positioning of the hand is going to change, because the position of the hand, and as you know, we want everything to come through looking like a fastball, that's a very comfortable straight on position of the wrist. And if you don't get all the energy to that normal wrist position prior to when the wrist and hand start to change their shape because of the pitch, you're never going to have a grip or data show up on a ball or on a screen or whatever that's going to be okay. So I just wanted to get that in there. You've got to be sure that the shoulder is bringing the hand into the release point in a specific way. And so everything I'm going to talk about is assuming that you have a pitcher who's not one leading with the elbow, which changes the entire lower arm position, or that he's not using his shoulder correctly, or his delivery just looks completely off. This is kind of a moment, Larry, where I would say, don't even give him the ball to throw with. Don't even measure him, because you got to deal with the delivery first. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And when the delivery's off, the data is going to be off too. Yeah. And that's the cool thing about it. It's all kind of consistent. So I'm always going to be in the department of teaching coaches how to deal with the delivery and the motion. But the way I'm looking at this for me right now, again, to make sure I'm staying in my lane, is that the wrist and the hand are part of the anatomy. So just as I teach you about what the shoulder should do and what the elbow should do, now we're going to talk about what the hand needs to do and where the pitcher can lose his grip on the ball that then makes nothing work correctly. So I think one of the most interesting things that I learned when I was really studying the fingers is that there's two places where the hand starts to have action against the ball. And there's a very critical path that the ball goes through that if you don't understand what's happening, you can quote unquote lose your grip. And because the body's moving so quickly, the most important thing, once I looked at everything, the most important thing I thought was, you know, the place you start is making sure that the ball is in the hand and the way it started in the hand out of the glove, and that in the process of all the speed of the body, you didn't lose the force against the ball. Because if you don't have your grip against the ball in the way that you want it to when you go to release it, you're not going to be able to get the action or the pull against the seams or the things that we want to see that make the ball go through the air in the way that we want a pitcher's ball to go through the air. So now I said this before on one show a long time ago, and it's so important. So when the pitcher rotates and he starts to face the plate, the ball is in his hand, and this is called max external rotation. And it's, if you're looking from the catcher view, it's when the shoulder is externally rotating so much. So in a really good pitcher, you'll see the forearm is parallel to the ground. The ball is in the hand and it's facing the sky. And then that place there is the place where it's the first time the hand is really under the ball, but the ball has to stay in the correct position in the fingers. Now, what's happening here is the speed is so great when he arrives in that position. And the next movement is he's going to start accelerating the ball, that the ball has to, the grip of the ball exerts the greatest amount of pressure at that moment. When they look at pressure coming out of the glove all the way through the motion, there is equivalent to like 45 pounds of pressure against that ball.
Your fingers against the ball?
Yes. There's pressure in your hand. So the hand is the palm and the fingers. And there's like 45 pounds of pressure. Of course, science calls it Newton meters, but I change this for everyone. There's like 45 pounds of pressure that hand has to have against the ball. In other words, what happens when the ball is released as the hand comes forward? So let me say this first, is the ball is going to roll up from the lowest part of the hands. It rolls up because your fingers are pulling down. Does that make sense, Larry?
Absolutely.
The ball rolls up because your fingers are pulling down. And anybody listening to this, I mean, having a baseball in your hand and just putting it in your non-dominant hand and putting your palm against it and pulling the fingers downward, you'll see that the ball is rolling up, but the hand is pulling it down. That's why the ball's rolling up. But you've got to understand that. So we've got a rolling ball situation. So when you're in the back position, you're in max external, and this is all happening in milliseconds now. The ball arrives there, and the next thing, you're coming through the acceleration path where now the ball, if you're not gripping it, would fall straight down to the ground. And you get that, right, Larry?
Correct. Is that
making sense?
Yep, for sure.
So you've got to grip that ball, so when you go through that, you're still hanging on to it until you go forward to the release point, at which point you pull and the ball rolls up, right? So one of the biggest problems is premature ball rolling. And this happens in kids especially, but it happened and the problem with it is during that process, and I'm not even going to go into the details of the knuckles and which joint does what. So we started this talking about spin. Okay. The ball has to stay in the air. So we have to impart spin on it. And the spin we're imparting is helping it get through the air. It's going to tell us when it's going to arrive and how it's going to arrive. Okay, all the crazy spin for different pitches. The only way you get spin is to have friction with the fingertips on the seams. So what does that mean? So we know the pitcher puts his fingers hopefully correctly on the seams in the glove, right? But when he moves through that motion and he gets to that backward position where we know because of forces that are happening in the motion, and this is all physics and complicated, but we know when he swings that ball around and gets it behind him, if he's not gripping it or he loses that, that ball starts moving, meaning his fingers started changing. And by the time he gets to the release point, he doesn't have that same friction capability on the seams. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
So it's a way of saying the ball moved in your hand before it was supposed to.
What would cause that?
Not having a firm enough grip at the right time.
Okay.
Now, what any human does is, so if I, if you have a gallon of water in your hand in front of you, you're gripping it a certain way. If I say, hey, throw that backwards, to me, you're going to naturally grip it tighter as you get to the top, and then you're going to let it go. It's not like we have to tell people, hey, if you're reaching behind you or you have something round in your hand and you're moving it through space, there's going to be moments when you're going to grip it tighter. This is also part of research. I mean, they've done research on the messaging that goes on between the hand and the brain during a pitch. I mean, it's incredible.
I want to see some of this stuff.
Well, you know what? But think about it. Of course, your brain is controlling everything. So when you go to pick up that gallon of water, you pick it up with just the right amount of force, right?
Right.
And if right next to it is a glass of water, you pick that up with the right amount of force, right?
Correct.
Yeah. And if I say, oh, throw this piece of paper into the garbage can, you know just how to throw it. It may or may not make the basket, but you do it. But if I'm giving you a brick and say, throw that into it, you're going to throw it. These are command centers in the brain that are picking up what you're doing because you don't realize it, but you've told your brain, hey, brain, I'm going to throw a brick now. Hey, brain, I'm going to throw a paper. It's picking up the sensation from your eyes, seeing what you're picking up. The inside of the body, the more you study it, it's so complicated, but it's so cool. We are very cool. Our bodies, our brains are very cool. So he's got this round thing in his hand. It's safe in the glove. He's coming out. He's moving horizontally behind him. He's got to get a grip on the ball so it doesn't fall out of his hand. Then his arm's turning over, and now he's behind him. And so the grip on the ball has to be maintained, meaning the fingertips and the thumb position and everything have to be solid to where he can hold on to the grip. And this is why you guys know this on some innate level, because whoever was the first pitcher that moved his thumb underneath or on the side or his finger over here or said, let's turn the seam this way. I mean, I don't know how that was designed. A bunch of guys drinking beer, playing with a baseball. I don't know. Who's the first one that said, hey, if I do this, it does this. I mean, I don't know how, but you guys intuitively know it. I mean, you already know this stuff. The thing is, we don't want a change. We don't want a change in that position of the ball. And what happens is we get a change in the position of the ball. The ball will roll up too soon. And that when you see a pitch go straight out of the hands, up in the air, over the catcher's head. I mean, it's like, whoa. He did not time the wrist and the finger pull at the right time, so he didn't pull against it. He didn't, if he doesn't pull against it with the right wrist action, then the ball won't go downward. Does that make sense?
Correct.
So if you throw a ball in the air, I don't want to say a volleyball because I don't want to talk about another sport, but if you just threw the baseball up in the air in front of you and smacked it forward with the palm of your hand, it's just going to go a certain way because you didn't flex your wrist over the top of it. Flexion is when you take your wrist and you bring your fingers towards your forearm. That's wrist flexion. So your palms away from you, you bring the fingers down, that's flexion. You either didn't do that, and when you're doing that, that's how you get to pull. The wrist pulls the fingertips down. So everyone, put your hand in the air, flex your wrist, pretend you're grabbing on or scraping on a wall is a good example. When you're scraping on a wall, if you just pull straight down with the fingertips, you're just putting finger marks on the wall. If you use your wrist as you're pulling down, now you're getting the pulling and the friction from the fingers. Does that make sense? So it's a timing of the wrist and fingertips. If that ball isn't in the hand in the way that you've got a good grip on it, so you have about 44 pounds of pressure on that ball when it's in the max external rotation position. Because guess why? Your brain knows you're about to throw it hard. To throw it hard, you better go from a good hold and then out the hand. You don't want to have a sloppy hold and then your hand's trying to find it. There's about 18 pounds of pressure that the fingers are applying to the ball. Now, as you're going through the air, the ball's pushing against your hand's pushing against it. We know this is physics. You know, you're standing up. The ground's pushing against you. You're pushing against the ground. It's how you stand. You want to jump high, you push against the ground. You lower yourself, you push up. This is like, you know, it's a law of physics. So that ball is pushing against you, and then that forces the hand to push forward, and that's how the ball comes out of the hand. So the fingertips against the seams, and here we're back to spin, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the fingertips have to be on the seams. They have to be exactly where you want them. That ball has to be held in the hand in an appropriate way to allow for whatever pitch you want, whatever velocity you want. But the main thing is that you, the pitcher, you, the coach, when you know the perfect grip and you know what you want him to do and you want his fingers in a certain way, the first thing you have to get is he hanging on to the ball so that when he gets to acceleration and release, he can actually do what he wants with that ball. It's not moving out of his hand sooner than he wanted. So we know we got to have some force back there, right?
Yes, absolutely.
But we also have to have correct finger positions.
Very much so. And the thing I think about when you talk like that, I just think, I mean, that to me, it's easy. The teach would be, I mean, there's a lot of different ways to say it. It will feel like you're letting go of the ball about eyebrow level. Throw the ball as late as you can. Throw 100% of the pitch. Usually when guys try to do too much, throw too hard, they miss up because they let go of the ball too soon. They're trying to overdo it. Usually because they're, generically speaking, they spin off the ball or they run away from the pitch. They let go of the ball too soon.
Right.
You want the ball in your hand as long as you can hold it in your hand, in my opinion.
Yes.
But you also don't want to hold it. If you hold it too long, you'll spike the hell out of it.
Yes.
You'll throw it straight to the ground. So it's an innate. It's just a, and that's more of a, to me, we talk about like, that's more feel. It's just a, it's just a really tough thing to describe, but a guy's ability to just have good enough feel where, and usually guys with good feel then have good control and good command. The better feel they have, because they have an innate ability to kind of know when to let go of the baseball and how to manipulate and spin the ball. But the teach for me would be, yeah, you just throw it as late as you can. It's going to feel, you don't literally, I don't believe, let go of the ball in front of your face, because if you did, you would throw it straight into the ground. But that, to me, that's the feel or that's the teach. If the guy is, a kid is missing high all the time, exceptionally high, or letting go of the ball too soon, or the grip, or he's, it could be a grip issue. I don't know. That's just the way I think of it.
Well, he's letting go of the ball too soon. If the ball position in his palm is such that it has to release sooner because he can't hold on to it. And we're going to talk about that in a second when we look at a photo. That's the first thing. But secondly, if he isn't positioned with his fingers in a strength position for his wrist, because the ball can't go anywhere unless the wrist moves it somewhere. If you notice, when I asked you to hold your hand out in front and flex, that hand goes downward, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
So it, because of the position of the arm, it's going, and we want downward trajectory. That's why the pitcher's on a hill. So you want him to hang on to the ball to do what he can do at the end of it, to at the release point. Yes, he's got to hang on to it. And so therefore, the grip has to be allowing him to get a good grip on it in the back, hang on to it until he moves the fingers. And yes, for some pitchers, this is probably intuitive. It may be the shape of their hand. They can hang on to it. But for pitchers, when you see a ball go awry, he did not roll through the ball, you move the ball through his hand in the correct way. So somewhere he lost something. And it could, it's just like, when I see a pitcher do something crazy with the ball, I'll look at him, I'll go, what happened? You go, it slipped out of my hand, which is what you're saying. The ball can't slip out of the hand. It has to be put to a certain place so your wrist and fingers can act on it. Does that make sense?
For sure.
Yeah, so the wrist and fingers have to act on it. And by the way, you're right. If your ball is too close to your head, you can't act on the ball in the same way as if your hand is reaching out front. That's why when in science we talk about velocity and we talk about a successful pitch, we want the good spin, you know, friction from the seams, and we want you releasing. If you want velocity, you got to have good spin, and you got to have, you got to reach out in front far enough, not only so you're releasing the ball closer to the plate, but so your wrist and hand can do what it wants. If it's real close to you and right up over your head, you can't pull against it. You're pulling down on it, but you're not pulling. You're not able to use the wrist to go over the ball and pull it at the same time. Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely.
See, so it's all what you're saying. But when you see that, you have to kind of in your head go, this guy's wrist is weird. You know, he's doing something weird with his wrist. If the ball is flying out of the hand, he's doing something weird with the wrist. If the ball rolls up too soon, he lost his grip. So there are connections you can make, and these are tools. So when you have to really go deeper with someone, you know, but to understand what's actually happening is so important. So does all that make sense?
For sure.
Okay, So to all my listeners, we're going to be looking at some photos here, and you can go to Angel Borrelli Pitching on YouTube, and you can not only listen to the podcast there, but if you're listening in the car and you want to see these photos, just go there and then look at the teaching moment, and you'll see the visuals that we're using. But for Larry, for you, go ahead and open up that photo number one, which is Larry, oh, who, by the way, you do know he's a lefty, so you're going to see this lefty grip. So he's doing his little four-seam grip here.
Got it.
Yes. So Larry's doing something really smart. So according to research, the further apart the fingers are, the slower the ball is going to go. And so you guys already know this, because if you wanted to throw a slower fastball, you would do something with your finger position. But every time you change your fingers, you're changing the range of motion of the wrist. And the wrist has to be right behind the ball, no matter what you're throwing. But if you change the position of the fingers, it changes how fast the wrist can flex or how slow it's going to flex. And sometimes it affects its range of motion. You guys know this because when you change a grip, you're moving the fingers around and you're moving the thumb around and you already know this. You just don't know that the reason why it's doing that is because of the wrist. So once we know that, and he's throwing a four seam here, and I know you wanted it to go really fast, right? So he's got the optimal position. He's got the two fingers on top and he's got the thumb right under the ball. And you see his wrist, how perfectly positioned it is behind the ball. So when he releases, if he brought that ball back right now, just in the position he's in, you'd see that as he came forward into the flexion, the wrist is controlling it so that the fingers are going to pull straight down on the seams, and he's going to pull those fingers backward, and then he's going to have perfect backspin, which is your velocity backspin, right?
Correct.
Am I right about that?
Backspin.
Yeah. And that thumb is so important because it is the thumb being all the way. The thumb has many actions that it does, and it's the strongest finger on the hand. And if you've ever had a thumb injury, you know that you can't grasp anything. With the thumb all the way under, it's actually putting it into an action, a joint action that's actually stabilizing that ball. And on research they're doing about location issues, which location issues usually stem from this back position I told you about, the max external. Remember, if you reverse engineer the ball release, your ball release is out in front. You take your arm all the way back, put it back where it was in max external rotation. You want that ball to go from there out, right? You don't want it to swing around or do whatever. You want a straight line. The thumb, some researchers are saying, and they're saying that more research has to be done, but it makes so sense to me because I understand the body, that the thumb position and the work of the thumb is what's controlling the ball and controlling probably your location, because if the thumb starts to move, the wrist gets wobbly. And then when you go to pull, and remember, the wrist is moving as you're pulling, then you're not going to have the right pull, which in your case, you want it even, right?
Yes, very.
Yes. So if that thumb wasn't allowing that from the max external to this, you'd be in trouble. So are thumbs important? Yes, they're very important. So what you've got here is a perfect position. And when I have a pitcher who has a weird thing going on with this foreseam, I used to just say, show me your foreseam. And then I look to see, I would make him flex and extend real fast with the ball in the hand. And I could tell by the way his wrist was moving is if he had his fingers in the optimal position. And most of the time it was the thumb that was throwing off the way the wrist was working. If the wrist can't flex up and down consistently in the same plane, you're doing something with your fingers. Now, we're talking about a foreseam because on other things, you do want that, right? But on this one, you don't want that. And we're going to kind of talk mostly about the foreseam because, you know, when you guys say in baseball, oh, you start with the foreseam, that's what you teach and everything comes off of that. Well, a pitcher, if he can understand the pressure needed, the wrist action needed, the positioning needed, he probably is going to learn everything else even better. So even on a kinesiological sense, this is the pitch they have to master. And kids who have trouble with this, when they come to me and they say, I can't, my foreseam's awful. Well, I know that every other thing they're doing is probably on sand. It's not on a good, strong foundation. So what I love about this is just it's so perfect. And by the way, Larry sent these to me randomly when I told him what I was going to be talking about. We didn't move his fingers around to make him look good.
Yep, that's it.
This is him. Yeah. So now listen, one thing I want to say. So this is a little tip. So notice you see his middle finger and you see his index finger is shorter, right? But because of the size of his hand, he's still got good positioning. So you see how his knuckles are sticking up in the air? You can see his fingernail. Okay, his knuckles are up. When he pulls on that ball, that knuckle right there, the first one, is going to straighten out, correct? You're rolling, it's going to straighten out. So the more contact he has with the seams, the longer the contact with the seams, the greater that pull is going to be. But by the way, he can't make that pull until the what moves? The wrist. Okay, so remember the wrist and when you've got that wrist locked in like that with that long finger, you're going to have really good direction. Because remember, the wrist is going to give help with the direction because your fingers are stemming from it. Now, here's a little tip for those of you who work with the little guys. So if you take that ball, so most times you look at a four-seam grip on a youth pitcher and he's going to have his fingers, his index finger may not make it to the seam. So he's either pulling that middle finger back and then the index finger is on a smooth part. So if you take that ball, see where it says Rawlings on the side? If you take it and flip it to where the wide side of the horseshoe is towards the middle finger, it's still a four-seam grip. But the narrow, see how the horseshoe sideways and it goes narrow? Remember, the horseshoe has different shapes. If you flip it the other way, the narrow part ends up by the index finger, so it's closer to the index finger, so he can get his fingers on the seam. See how the biggest part of the horseshoe is towards the shortest part of the index finger? It doesn't change anything, Larry. It just gives the index finger contact with the seam the way you're doing it. So that's a little tip for those of you who work with kids. Now, does that make sense to you?
Absolutely.
Yeah, so that's a little thing. A lot of times, in fact, Larry, this has been what I think started this, when a pitcher's hand is too small, how do you deal with that? Well, first, manipulate the ball a little bit. Still with the grip you want, guys. I'm not telling you how to do different grips or whatever, but all you did is take the object and you turned it. So now the horseshoe's facing, so it's still the horizontal horseshoe, but now the index finger can get on a seam.
Right. Now I have a question. When you say the fingertips on the seam, what's comfortable to me and what I think is the best way to do it, but I could be wrong, is I like the top two knuckles. I like the seam to sit in the top two knuckles. Is that what you mean by the fingertip pulling on the seam?
Yes.
Or okay, because I don't want that to be confused by the finger pads, the top finger pads on the seam. I would almost prefer the joints, the top two knuckles or the top two joints of my fingers in the seam sitting in that as opposed to the finger pads sitting on the seam.
Yeah, no. Well, first of all, on the index finger, that's why I said you change it. But yeah,
yep.
So guys, the knuckles are the joints and the joints move to pull the body part. Now, if you look at your hand and look at all your knuckles on your palm, we're not talking about these knuckles on the fingers now. Make a fist and eat all these knuckles. That joint that's right there between the fingers and those knuckles is one of the most important joints in pitching. And it's the joint that moves first to uncouple the ball from the hand so the ball gets far enough away so you can pull with the fingertips. Okay. And yes, this is what I was just getting into saying. When you look at four-seam grips, you're going to see guys, in fact, I think I said this to you the other day, guys who have the seam under the knuckle. So when the knuckle straightens and that causes the pulling of the pad, the knuckle can't pull the pad. The tissue rubs against the pad. The knuckle's moving the tip down, right? If he's on the seams, you know, he barely is getting that knuckle over it. When he pulls, he's pulling on the smooth part. Okay. So the tip to be in touch right over the edge. So yes, and that's a good, a better way to say it, Larry. So I'm glad you brought that up. The tip has to pull across the seam for as long as possible. And my better pitchers, they get right up over it so that when that knuckle starts to move, the seam is then presented to the pad. That's why if you change the horseshoe shape, the index finger has more of the same that the middle finger is going to have. Can you see how the difference of positioning is? But yours is perfect, so you don't need to do that. But for your little kids, when you're looking at joint problems, that's what you want to look at. Now, if Larry took his thumb and moved it up the side of that pitch, he's going to reduce his velocity because that spin isn't going to be as directed. And he's changing the way the wrist is going to work. So he's going to have some probably different type of movement on it. So the thumb under the middle gives it that direct relationship. And now you've got the middle finger and the thumb supporting that wrist. And now the wrist velocity can impart itself into the fingers which pull backward. Does that make sense? So that thumb position is perfect. So what you see with little kids, because when you, if you grab a ball and you put the thumb under the middle, you might go, whoa, that's a real stretch for that thumb. But you have to do it. The thumb actually does that action. It's like if you put your thumb inside your palm, it actually does that. In fact, by the way, Olympic power lifters, when we are trying to get a good grasp on the bar, so it doesn't move in, the bar is moving in space pretty fast on Olympic lift. The grasp is you put the thumb exactly, you put your thumb under your fingers like that on the bar. You are actually using a thumb inside the grip, grasp on the bar, and it controls the wrist. So what you're getting here is optimum control. So when you've got a four seam, a pitcher throwing a four seam, and you don't know what the heck's wrong, but it doesn't look right, have him hold it out and try his thumb. Every pitcher, and also the fingers being close together. Because remember, if the fingers the further apart, you're going to get a little less velocity. If you have the thumb up the side, so by bringing everything in alignment like this, then you get the wrist to act correctly, which makes the fingers act correctly. So remember this, wrist motion controls finger motion. Wrist motion controls finger motion. If you remember that, then you can take a look at where the thumb is, the fingers are, and then you start with that. It makes, it does, makes magical changes.
Awesome. Good stuff. I was kind of tinkering around too. Had my hand in front of my face. And when I stick my thumb underneath my fingers, my wrist, the hinge, it hinges or works pretty good. Stick your thumb directly, point it straight out or to the inside of your body, point it to the direction of your index finger, and it doesn't move as clean.
Yes, it's huge. Clean. Love that word, clean. This is clean, guys. And this is based on, so I'm going to remind everyone, I'm not trying to be a pitching coach. I am being an analytical kinesiologist, which is what I am, analyzing how you get efficient movement through the hand, just like you get efficient movement when I talk about the way the hips work or the shoulder works. So this is so important. So let's get to the second picture here. We talked a little bit about the position in the hand. Now, Larry sent me this. This is from one of his youth pitchers, and he knew something was wrong, and he probably, we didn't discuss it, but he already, I'm sure, knows this. So I wanted to confirm with Larry that this kid is, in fact, thinking he's throwing a four-seam fastball. He's not like, it's not got some other name. He's throwing a four-seam. So is this pitch, is this grip here going to be efficient for him, so that he can accomplish what he wants to accomplish with the forcing, which is the fastest and the straightest pitch? So this is the clean, pure, get it out there, get it fast, drill it right where you want to put it. So on this picture here, the problem he has, well, we were just talking about the thumb. So if we looked at this from the front, his thumb is probably to the side, but that's not the real issue yet. That ball is sitting so far back in his hand that that ball, this is where you want to change up grip. You want the ball back closer in the hand, but what he's, the ball is so far back in his hands that the way it's going to come out of his hand is sooner than the way it needs to come out, so the ball can do all the things it does, which is to roll up. It rolls up so you can pull down. Rolling up, pulling down, one big thing. When it's way back in the palm of the hand like that, that's not going to happen. Now, the other thing, and this is why you guys, whoever made up the changeup, whatever amount of beer he was drinking that night, he figured out, hey, My wrist barely moves when it's in, you know, it's like there's something different. There's a different range of motion. But the biggest thing is, and this is one of the things my advisor in graduate school told me, he said, Angel, you know why the changeup moves slower? I go, why? And I was just a graduate student, not even really knowing pitching yet. And he goes, because the lever is shorter. So guys, when the ball's in your fingertips, you're hitting your driver. when your ball's in the palm of your hand, you're using your putter. That's the way, that's why your clubs are different lengths in golf, because its maximum distance is controlled by how that lever is, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you don't dig dirt out of the ground with the spoon. You get a spoon with a longer handle. You do more, right? Okay. Those are levers, lever mechanics. So the lever, see the wrist here? The lever now is much shorter from that to the end. That if that ball was way out there, then you've got a different lever length. So now you've got a different lever length between the ball and the joint than the fastball. So what's wrong with this guy? And then if he gets the ball out there, Larry, my guess is his thumb. See where his thumb is stretched? If you told him right now to move his thumb under, the ball would have to rotate. He's got no room in that joint because that joint now is doing a different action. And I don't want to bore you with the names. You get the ball out in the fingertips. Just picture it. Freeze up that smooth joint you're seeing there between the index and the thumb. And that thumb can move underneath because now the joint can go into a different action, which is what we would want for that thumb to be more underneath the ball. Could you get that?
For sure.
Yeah. So that's the interesting thing about that. Now, one more thing, one more photo before we close, because I have smoke coming out of my ears right now. Do you, Larry?
It's pretty deep. Yeah.
Exactly. So this is Larry's. Hey, Larry, am I going to be arrested for giving away your secret grips?
No, I'm long gone. Okay. I'm long gone. Never was an issue anyway.
Okay, Larry's changeup. This is what he throws, the way he throws his changeup. Okay, now, this is something I would be out of my lane talking about this grip or whatever, so I'm going to keep it with all that we've talked about. So now he's using a two-seam grip, right?
Correct.
Okay, now, when he sent me this, and tell the world what this is called, because I'd never heard of it, but I'm not a baseball person.
A Fosh.
Okay. See, I never heard that word.
I don't know why it's called that.
Yes.
You got to, circle change and pitchfork change, all these different variations, and there's no right or wrong way to do it. You're just killing velocity. So it's called a Fosh.
Yes. Yeah, so anyway, he spread his fingers apart to get slower.
Correct.
But his thumb's in the middle to get good direction.
Yep. And I choke and you can't see it. But if you turn it to the side, the ball would be choked or deep in my grip, not in my palm, but it's deep in the grip.
Deep in the grip. Okay. So we've got all the components we just talked about. So he's controlling his wrist speed with where the ball is in his hand. He's controlling direction, which the thumb not being off center. And then he's got the two seam grip on top with the fingers further apart. Now, here's another one of these little baseball tricks. So if you have a pitcher, and I couldn't believe it because I saw this grip on someone the other day, and most of my guys don't throw this changeup because I look at grips all day, but they don't throw this one. But anyway, I had somebody come in who was throwing this, and this is before I got the picture. And he was having trouble with it. The catcher, we weren't using the pitch logic ball. So I wasn't measuring speed, but the pitcher said, Angel, and I wish I could remember everything he said. He said, it's got a good speed change, but it's not coming in and dropping the way you want, blah, blah, blah. And he's giving me feedback. So, of course, the first thing I say, because, by the way, his mechanics are good enough to where he's locating everything else. See, when you've got someone who's doing a good job, then one thing doesn't work, go to the grip. So he shows me his grip. And it looks exactly like this. So when Larry sent me this picture, I went, oh my God, it's that Fosh grip or whatever. But the horseshoe. So we've got the horseshoe facing down. Okay. And so see the narrow part of the horseshoe's up at the top. And what this pitcher did that was different is he had the ball more in his fingertips. So I told him to move it back. But he also he wanted that top finger on the seam more. But here's what we had. He had the horseshoe turned backwards towards your body, Larry. So the bottom of the horseshoe was in the middle.
Yep.
And so he was, his fingers were way spread out over the seams, like way apart. And I said, is that comfortable? He says, well, it's the way I throw it, but it doesn't do what I want it to do. So I said, let's turn the ball. So we turned it towards the position you're in, which brings the narrowness of the seams to the top. Now he's still doing what he wants. He wants his two fingers over the top of a two seam grip. But because the horseshoe part is more narrow, he could get them more over the seam. And because he was right on the seams, he was able to pull down for longer over that curve, the curve of the ball. Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely.
So now he's getting, what rules he following now? The time of the friction, pulling, the time of the contact with the seam so that he can get even more friction. So cool, right?
Interesting. Yeah, pretty cool. Yeah, and I always thought of just if fastball is out of my grip as far as I can hold it without losing control of it, fingers together, then what are the exact opposites of all those things? I'm going to spread my fingers. I'm going to get it deep in my grip. I'm going to or take my two fingers or my power fingers, my index and middle finger off the ball, which then you deal with circle change and various type changeups. So yeah, that's how I think of it.
That no, and you know what? That's genius, and it's fantastic. And I'm going to get letters saying, "Could Larry do the show, Angel, and maybe you could be the guest?"
No.
It is total genius, and this is what I mean. I've always said this: you coaches are way smarter than you know, and you say things in an easy way. I hope that I can add more knowledge to confirm for you guys what you already knew, and sometimes maybe even give you an extra thing to look at or think about. So I love this. So I want to keep this last segment of the show short. And in my last segment, I'm going to call this my favorite name, engineering the pitcher. So if we want to engineer his hand so that he can do all of what we said, especially given what I'm telling you. You know, we talk about 44 pounds of pressure in the back and 18 pounds. Well, nobody's measuring that. And this doesn't mean you should hold a 44-pound plate in your hand back there. But what it means is we have to have strong fingers. And the fingers move separately from the palm. And then they also move as the wrist is moving. The most critical strength for the pitcher is in his fingers and in his wrist. And, you know, I've been wondering, why are there so many forearm injuries right now in pitching? Well, I don't think the guys were prepared. Okay. I think they were sitting around drinking beer thinking the season was never going to start. And if your forearm and wrist and fingers aren't in shape, you will get forearm pain. And we don't want forearm pain because we all know it leads to UCL problems. Plus, it's a nasty thing to have hurting. And of course, now that you see the role of the fingers in the hand, you've got to keep all the structures around the wrist healthy. So we've got to do wrist work. We've got to do finger work. And it has to be in relationship to the way the ball is used. Your fingers are in a curved position grabbing the ball, and then they straighten. They straighten as the ball is released. Your wrist is moving through flexion and extension all the time. For a curve ball, it's moving through sort of that chopping action where the little finger flexes towards the forearm. Your hand is sideways. So we've got to honor the importance of the not just the wrist, which I've always been a big proponent of, but also you have to honor the needs of the fingers. So everybody, get out your rice buckets, get out your putty. I love to take a baseball and just hold it out in front of me and drop it, and then I grab it, drop and grab, and I even throw it in front of me, throw it out and grab it in space. And what you do is you get fast contractions. So I want everyone to add this to the repertoire. Get the fingers strong. Rice buckets, anything you can think of. There's tons of things on the market to strengthen the wrists. And remember the fingers. And then remember to add the wrists into that as well. So there it is. We did it.
No, that's huge. That's huge. It's just I think it's a really important topic that you don't, you know, hear anybody talk about a whole lot. And so it's informative. I hope it's helped people. I mean, it helps me think about it differently, and it's really good. It's a great topic.
Absolutely. So everyone, thank you so much for tuning in, and we will be back in 3 weeks, and who knows what we're going to be talking about next. Remember, you can email me at angel@gymscience.com. You can go to my Facebook page at Angel Borrelli Pitching or YouTube Angel Borrelli Pitching to see the photos we were talking about. Never hesitate to contact me with any questions you have, and if you have suggestions for topics, be sure and send them in. So thank you so much for listening. And thank you, Larry, for everything.
Thank you very much, Angel. I appreciate it.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.